same gender identity. Because of this commission, and not because the commission of a crime, not because this person committed any kind of a crime, it's simply because of the gender identity they say, but they believe that others may want to give them a different gender identity, or they want to go hold them to a different standard. From its inception, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts has always stood for the concept of equal protection under the law. These core values reflected in the Massachusetts Declaration of Human Rights, and as I stated earlier, later the U.S. Constitution. These core values were reflected in the Commonwealth's long history of being a leader in the area of civil rights. From the Quad Walker case in 1781, in which the Supreme Judicial Court held, that slavery was inconsistent with the Massachusetts Constitution, which led to Massachusetts being the center of the abolitionist movement. The establishment, through history, you can look at the establishment of the MCAD in 1946. At a time in 1946, most of the country was looking at civil rights. To the good of these public health decisions, and today, I believe this will be reflected in the passage of this bill. For that reason, the MCAD strongly supports the passage of this bill to ensure that all citizens in the Commonwealth are given equal access to public accommodations without regard to their sex, class, status, or gender identity. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm formally here in my position as one of the two vice chairs of the Massachusetts Commission on LGBT. But I'm also here as a young person. I'm 19 years old. I'm here as someone who has gone through the Massachusetts public school system. I'm a 2012 graduate of Danvers High School on the North Shore. And I'm also here as a friend and peer of transgender and gender nonconforming youth. I would like to highlight that the commission, we create policies that enable Massachusetts youth to thrive, particularly LGBT youth. And as legislatively mandated, we see this bill as essential for allowing young trans people to participate fully in their communities. We truly heard this at our hearings in 2012. We held public hearings in Boston and Holyoke, in which youth from across the state came and testified. And I'd like to highlight one instance where a youth worker described a young person being forced to turn to unsafe alternatives when discriminated against at public accommodations, such as a young trans man whom she knew who had to sleep outside or in abandoned buildings due to personal safety concerns at area homeless shelters. And something that this youth worker said was, and I quote, he often stayed by himself outside and moved from couch to couch. He found shelter in abandoned buildings. There shouldn't ever be a reason that these options are safer than a shelter for a trans guy, and but this is where he found himself. She said to us, I'm here to tell you that we can do better than this. This cannot be the best we have to offer. And so I'm here before you today to ask you, do you think that this is the best that we have to offer to our young people in particular, our young trans and gender non-conforming youth? Do you think that we can offer them something better, or is this the standard that we're willing to set for them? Thank you.
The commission, which is a legislatively mandated body, to really look at policies and programs that we need across state government to ensure that public can thrive. We're particularly concerned around access to health services. And we have found both in our testimony, which we've received in anecdotal evidence, as well as in research, that more than half of parents and guardians of transgender youth report significant challenges in finding and accessing appropriate physical and mental health care for their children. These families often report that they receive inappropriate physical care, they have to travel long distances to receive this care, or even have to become educators themselves, the medical professionals we're going to see on issues dealing with gender identity. And then we found the lack of access to suitable services, putting the physical and mental health and safety of transgender children and young adults at risk in the Commonwealth. The LGBTQ Commission has also worked extensively with schools and communities on the implementation of an act relative to gender identity, which this committee had put forward and the legislature signed put through and enacted. And there were a lot of concerns from a certain group of constituents around the act relative to gender identity, and those concerns have not been lost. And you know, the commission has a unique role in that we are the sole state-funded entity to support technical assistance and professional development relative to implementation of both the anti-bullying law and an act relative to gender identity. And we've been engaged with about approximately 150 schools across the state. And so within the course of that work, we've gotten to hear a lot of feedback. And what we found is that students, educators, communities, they've been really eager to learn how best to support transgender young people, have welcomed the enactment of gender identity, will welcome this law. They've welcomed the subsequent guidance issued by the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education and other guidance the past administration has put out in working with the commission. And we really feel, you know, as a legislatively mandated commission, it's really time that we ensure that all youth can access public accommodations outside of school settings, and really this is a critical, this is an issue of critical health and safety, really allowing young people across the state to reach their full potential. So thank you for your time, and we appreciate your testimony.
Thank you for your testimony. Any other questions?
Thank you.
I'm not sure if you want to take the question. They would be protected and we access to that already as they would be along with any other protected class, I guess is the way I would understand it.
All right. The amendment was to Chapter 151B, which basically that's the MTAB's jurisdiction. And when that bill was passed, it specified in the areas of employment housing, and it was limited to those areas. It did not even include public accommodations. Medical care, hospitals are considered a place of public accommodation. Restaurants are considered a place of public accommodation. Buses, all of the things I mentioned before, those are considered places of public accommodation. And so what would happen is, in those areas, it is not, at the present time, illegal per se to provide services in that area. Now, as I stated before, the MCAB, what we have done is we have prosecuted those cases where they face, for example, where somebody says, you don't act like a boy is supposed to act, like a girl is supposed to act. You don't do this. So it's a form of sexual stereotyping. It's gender stereotyping or sexual stereotyping. But why to any person in the world, be it straight, gay, transgender, whatever. But under that theory, but if the person were to say, well, we're not serving you, we're not allowing you, and for example, scenario to return to restaurant, transgender individual would come in the restaurant and say, we don't serve transgender individuals, you cannot come in. You have to leave. If the person didn't leave, the restaurant owner, under the law, it was written today, we go and have the person removed.
But again, they've been added to the list. You, as the MCAD personnel, you enforce any discrimination against somebody based upon their membership in a protected class.
But the protected class for a transgender individual in the bill was only in the area of housing and employment. It was not generally the 151B. That's what I'm trying to clarify.
I think the exclusion that was attempted, that we attempted to make that thing when that law was passed by the House was that it wasn't a bathroom bill. But I believe the notwithstanding, and maybe I'm reading that wrong at the end, sort of encompasses a lot of other, I mean, we didn't, just as you would with any other protected class, you don't itemize every place that they can ever be discriminated against. You basically assess that they are in fact in a protected class, and therefore they can't be discriminated based upon that bathroom.
bill, when the bill was being passed, the time was very contested here. And I believe because the bill was being trumpeted in the bathroom bill, which is stated, because of that, I believe that's part of the reason why public accommodations were specifically removed from the original.
So you're saying the word should have been bathroom or locker room, they would have eliminated
it. It just said public accommodations. If it had said employment, housing, and public accommodations, it would have encompassed all those areas. By saying employment and housing, it specifically did not include public accommodations. And so what I'm saying is this. If we were to go and say, let's say this company could go bring a claim, and we were going to say that we found probable cause, the MTA did, in regards to discrimination on gender identity in a place of public accommodation, and we were to go forward to the hearing, if I was the person who represented us, if I was the defense attorney, the person representing the respondent, what I would say is that this is beyond your statutory authority. And even if they were to, their person were to eventually rule that the MTA would have the right to appeal to a court. And of course, in reviewing the statute, we believe at this time would say that this is not given within your statutory authority. It's beyond your statutory authority. And so for that reason, that's why we want public accommodations added. This added has protected class within public accommodations.
Has there been any judicial, you said if a judge were to hear one of these cases, they would deny it. Has there been any litigation that has come to any judicial determination?
At this point, we have not prosecuted a case under gender identity for public accommodation because one of the things we tell our staff is if we don't have the authority under this statute, we're not going to do it. Because it doesn't do the Commonwealth any good if it's citizens of the Commonwealth. I can tell you that I talked to a representative from the CCHRO, that's the Connecticut Commission on Human Rights and Opportunity. They're basically the equivalent, Connecticut's equivalent of the MCAB. I wanted to do that before I came here because I wanted to have that idea. Connecticut had passed through this bill back in 2011 for a similar bill. I wanted to have an idea of exactly how many cases they've had, the type of cases. And what they said is that there's been some, but there really haven't been a lot of cases. In other words, there wasn't the type, in the same way there was a lot of controversy, people were concerned about how it would affect the public, saying all these things would happen. And they found that basically those things did not happen. That most places in public accommodation, like everywhere else, they accepted it and they moved on.
So theirs did include bathrooms and locker rooms in their statute. Okay.
Yes, and obviously there had to be some period of adjustment for something. They have something specifically written in the statute in a way that Massachusetts does not have it. But there's a period of public accommodations, bathrooms, lockers, yes, in the state of Connecticut. And I just mentioned Connecticut because I'm from the best portion of the state, Western Mass, so we border Connecticut, so I'm very familiar with the Connecticut statute.
I also like to add, I think we're really trying to set the standard here, and the more specific we are, the better the standard. So you're talking about public accommodations being streets, hotels, restaurants, all the places, and public transportation. So these are services and areas which we all use on a daily basis, and quite frankly,